Good morning, and welcome as we come together again to worship God, separate from one another, and yet meeting in God's presence, ourselves and with believers round the world. We welcome you as we gather around God's word, whether you're regular members of our congregation, whether you haven't been out for a while, or whether you're hearing this through the recommendation of family and friends, maybe not necessarily even in this country. May you know God's blessing. It's hard to believe that this is us going into our second month outside of church. This is the fifth Sunday when we've been meeting together in this format. So we start to move on now from Easter, and we celebrate Christ risen and the fact that he is still alive. Take time to reflect on God's majesty and God's glory. And we're going to begin, as we have been, with a song. Whether you sing along or reflect on the words as Sarah, Richard, and Nicholas lead us, let's sing together, "Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son." Now let's pray together. Lord, you are the God of eternity. You're the God of history. We know that. We live each day as it comes, and we know that we do not know what another day will bring. And in many ways, it's hard to believe that this is our fifth Sunday where we've been advised to stay out of the church building together because of this virus. Lord, as we bow before you today, we want to thank you that you've been watching over us in the time that we have spent absent from one another, but present with you. We thank you, Lord, for the changes in this springtime as we see the signs of your good care and love for us in creation. For those who have continued to maintain those things that are important to us, the food on the table, and those who provide it, our health and strength, and those who are caring for us and caring for our loved ones. We think, Lord, especially of those in hospital and those in nursing home who, because of the situation, do not receive visitors from family. Be near to them. Be near to the health workers and the hospital staff and those in nursing home and those out in the community as they bring your love to others. Keep them safe. Give them strength, compassion, and wisdom. And Lord, on this first day of the week, we continue to celebrate the glorious truth that Jesus is risen, that you are our great hope, and may that hope shine within us. We rejoice in your love. We rejoice in what Resurrection Day stands for, that your sacrifice was acceptable to the Holy Father, that your love shines forever and ever, and that we have access to the throne of God. We bow before you, Lord Jesus, that great high priest who has gone before us and who intercedes for us. And we come to worship, to celebrate your love. Lord, let us hear your voice today. And though we are limited in our travel, though we are limited in our contact with people, help us to be transformed by your word. And in this time that you have given us, we pray, Father, that you will accept our worship, that you will cleanse us and renew us, that you will bless us and our families, those who are precious to us, and those who need your help. Draw near to us in Jesus' name, for we ask it for your glory, that your Holy Spirit would work in us. Amen. We're going to consider together today John chapter 21, verses 1 to 25. John chapter 21, and God's word speaks to us of this time after the resurrection. Let us hear God's word.
John chapter 21, verses 1 to 25. Jesus and the miraculous catch of fish. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them. And they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat. But that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore. But the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered. He said, throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there, with fish on it, and some bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish you have just caught. So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to him, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. Jesus reinstates Peter. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said. "You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt, because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourselves and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved was following them. This was the one who had leaned back against Jesus at the supper and had said, "Lord, who is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he asked, "Lord, what about him?" Jesus answered, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me." Because of this, the rumor spread among the believers that the disciple would not die. But Jesus did not say that he would not die. He only said, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you?" This is the disciple who testifies to these things and who wrote them down. We know that his testimony is true. Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have room for the books that would be written. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Adam. We know that this is God's word, and we want to turn to that now. So let's consider then together what God has to say to us from John chapter 21. It's set after Easter. And it's at a time, a strange time for the disciples. In our world today, people are feeling stuck. And they're wondering what we're going to do. Now, at the start of each of my talks, I've been setting little challenges for us. And I want us to think about those today as next week we move on to other topics. But I want just to take time to reflect on those four challenges that you've been given and to see how you're getting on. Whether it's to do with children, whether it's to do with adults, we all can play our part to those that appeal to us. There's something there for everyone. The challenges have been to review and to find the flowers, to consider the flowers of the field, to get to know some of their names. And children, if you're getting on well with that, there's another challenge you can add to it. And one of the things that I had to learn when I was a child was to identify the trees by their leaves. Most of us have forgotten how to do that, but there's plenty to help us. And maybe adults, we could be refreshed in that. Because as we come to spring, flowers are coming up, trees are changing, and we can get to know something of God's creation. Second time we met together this way was when I challenged us to consider what time was about, what was important time and what was ordinary time, and to measure the time to work out how long a minute was. So keep thinking of the time that God gives us. Third challenge was about making memories, putting down a marker, maybe to write something, to paint or draw something. Something creative that you can look back on. Something maybe that you can bring when we meet together in church. And we can rejoice in this marker that said God provided. And the fourth challenge last week on Easter Sunday, I've just put it down as potting plants because it both starts with the same letter. But it's really about restoring what is broken. Maybe creating a new flower bed or planting a tree or some furniture or something. And a reminder again that we can hold on to as we move forward, that in this time of uncertainty, that God provides what we need. So I want you to think about those. Maybe have a chat about them now or at the end of the service, and to take on one. If you're anything like me, quite often you hear these things and think, oh yes, that's a good idea, but don't actually get round to doing anything. Well, maybe this is the time for you, if you're in with a family, to get a commitment from one another, or maybe just individually to say, you know what, I will take that project on. I will actually learn what tree is what. I will make something new. But most of all, of course, our challenge in this time is to get to know the people around us and to get to know God. Because the story doesn't just stop. There are these great events that happen, some of them good, some of them bad. But God continues to look after things. And as we get to John chapter 21, we find this for Peter and the disciples. The first thing we see in John chapter 21, now John chapter 20 tells us about the resurrection. This was amazing. And it also tells us about how Jesus met with them in the upper room. Awesome. We know from Acts chapter 1 that Jesus was around for 40 days. So sometime after that, and doesn't it show how quickly we can forget? We find that Peter is tempted by the old routine. When I listen to people, including some of the prayer requests that are being put out there, it's as if our big concern is that everything will go back to the way that it was. I honestly don't think we should be praying that. I think this is an opportunity where we work out what's really important. And as Christians, as believers, we're to do so in the light of the resurrection. But here's Peter. Peter, who saw Jesus being taken. He stood up for Jesus in the wrong way. He denied Jesus. And he finds himself in this strange place where he knew he did something really bad that he should not have done. And he has nowhere to hide because Jesus knew he would do it. He saw Jesus crucified and thought that was it all over. And yet Jesus is back again. And Jesus has already singled him out. And Peter's in this kind of strange position of knowing that Jesus is alive, but not really sure where he stands with him. And he says, you know, let's go back fishing. It's the work that he did. It's his whole life, really. It's the skill that he had. It was his interest as well, no doubt. I personally am not that fond of fish, but that was Peter's livelihood. He's going back to the familiar. But his life's not going to be the same. And for many of us, and if we share our testimonies with one another, I think many of us will say, you know, when I first became a Christian, I was really excited. But after a while, I was tempted just to go back to the old routine. And it was hard to see God in the things that I always did, and I kind of drifted away. There will be Christians who are like that at the minute. It's the same all over. It's the same in many people's story. Maybe it's your story at the moment. You've drifted back to a familiar life where you believe in God, but he's not really making a difference day by day. And it happens especially and starts especially when we've done something wrong. When we know we've let God down. And we think, you know what, if I was a proper Christian, I wouldn't have done that. God is going to be disappointed in me. God is not that interested in me. I'm going to go back to what I know. So off they go. They go off fishing. There's seven of the disciples there. The picture has only got one little man in the fishing boat. But there were seven of them out in a bigger boat, and they tried for the night, but it didn't really satisfy, and it never does. And so as they're out in the boat, someone comes, just like I was standing on the shore, and if I'd called that man, he could have turned and spoken to me. And this man on the shore speaks to them, asks how they're getting on, not good. And he says, well, why don't you try again? And when they put the nets out again, there is this massive catch of fish. 153 fish, we're told. Some say that 153 is the number of the known nations. Now, remember at the very start, Jesus had said to Peter, come and follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. At the very start, when Jesus first met them at the boats, they'd gone out and they'd tried to fish, and they hadn't caught anything. And Jesus advises them, and they catch fish that nearly sink the boats. And so John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, he puts it all together very quickly in his brain. And he says, you know, that's the Lord. Because we're never out of his sight, you know. Even if we're going back to the old routine. And again, many Christian testimonies will say something along these lines. You know, I might have forgotten about God, but he never forgot about me. And so John and the disciples are in the boat, and they see this power of the resurrection, that Jesus is with them. Jesus is not just a passive truth. And Peter is so thrilled. Peter gets out of the boat and he wades across to be the first one to Jesus. Resurrection is not passive. Resurrection is something that transforms our lives. Salvation is not passive, right? If my sins are forgiven, I can do whatever. I'll just wait for heaven. No. Salvation is transforming. God will not leave us in our past. God will not let us stay in our old routines. He brings a new reality into our lives. And he brings a desire to be with Jesus, even though there may be obstacles in your way at the moment. There is something within us that still reaches out to Jesus, isn't there? We're drawn by this new reality. Christ is risen. Christ Jesus is with us. And so Peter is drawn back. Yes, he's denied Jesus. Yes, he's headstrong. All those things. But Jesus is still there. And so he makes his way to him. And then they sit down together. Jesus prepares a meal for them at the side of the lake. And what we find now is a work in progress, where Jesus is restoring a new relationship. Photograph is of our tuned-in meeting last year at the beach. Mark Lynch was speaking at that point, but here in John chapter 21, this is breakfast at the beach with Jesus. And then Jesus takes Peter aside. This is one of these powerful conversations in life. Life-changing conversations that takes place between an ordinary person and the Lord. It's a conversation that restores. Remember, three times Peter denied the Lord. And three times, driving at home each time, still sends a shiver down my spine as you feel your way into this story. Jesus asks the same question. Do you love me more than these? But I want you to notice something. He doesn't call him Peter. Peter means rock. That was the strong name. Just calls him Simon. Back to the old ways. But Jesus is restoring him to a new relationship. Do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than these? Do you really love me more than these? And each time it reaches into Peter's heart. And Peter says, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. In fact, he's getting a little bit annoyed again towards the end when Jesus keeps asking, but three times Now, if you think carefully about the title that I've given this, it's restored to a new relationship. In some ways, that doesn't make sense. It should be restored to a previous relationship. It should be restored to what was, because that's what restoration is. But with Jesus, it's never the same again. And when he restores us, he doesn't restore us to the old ways to leave us just back to square one. He restores us to move us forward. And so he says, feed my sheep, feed my lambs. Peter, you have a job to do. And he goes on to say it's not an easy job. This new relationship that he will have, which will be as leader of the church, it's not going to be easy. In fact, it's going to end in your death. And then he says words that Peter had heard 3 years before. Two words that still apply to us. He says, follow me. And we find this invitation to Peter to follow the one Redeemer. Follow me. And Peter does what many of us do. He takes a wee look around him. Have you ever been that whenever, whether it's at school with a teacher looking down at you or somebody, and they're looking straight at you, and the first thing you do is look around to see if it's somebody else involved. And he sees John, the disciple whom Jesus loves, and he says, what about him? What's going to happen to him? What about that? People can be very good at telling other people how to do their jobs. Do you find that sometimes when, depending on what your job is, that there are plenty of experts out there telling, knowing how you should do the job that you've been called to do, you've been asked to do. Plenty of people can say, what about him? And we do it ourselves with other people when it's us that's in attention. Before you start on me, what about them? And Jesus says, in words to Peter that still come to us, he says, what is that to you? You follow me. We need to hear that too at a very personal level as believers. This is your choice with God. And when God speaks to you, it's not your concern what he's saying to other people. Even if it is your husband or your parent, your child, a friend that you have. When Jesus says to you, follow me. He says it on the back of saying, do you love me more than these? He's not saying where the path will lead. In Peter's case, he did. He said, it's going to be tough, but you follow me. But what he says to you and to me, maybe for the first time for some of us, maybe to be restored for some of us, he says, if you're ready to give up your old routine, if you're being drawn by this new reality of a Jesus Christ who has risen from the dead, if you find yourself being restored to peace with God in your life that will never be the same again, if you're open to do that, if you're willing to say, yes, Lord, I love you, then hear the words of Jesus to you today. Follow me. Don't think about others. Jesus does tell us to count the cost. He tells of those who are invited to follow him, and then, but they've something else to do. They've property to see about. They've family to care for. They have work to see to. But he says, no, no. If you put your hand to the plow, you don't look back. He says, you follow me. Over this past week, we've seen in the Easter story how Jesus went to the cross because he loves us. He gave up his life because he loves us. He rose from the dead because he is more powerful than anything we will ever face. And he has opened a place in heaven to those who love him. And so those words come filled with love and with hope. In our picture, I'm not sure if that certain gentleman actually did head up that path up the sand dunes at the White Rocks on that particular occasion. Somebody else had. That was their path. And Jesus says to you, you follow me in the path that I've laid out for you. Will you do that? Even if it is in the quietness of your own home for the next while. Let's pray together. Lord, you ask us to follow you. We know, Lord, that those words are not hard to understand in terms of meaning, but they're very hard for us to understand in the way that it will affect our lives. We know, Lord, when you spoke them to Peter, you asked him to look after your people, and you also told him that his life would be cut short because he would face opposition. And we don't expect to hear that, Lord, but we know that things are changing in our society, and we're being asked to stand up and be counted for Jesus. But as we consider this wonderful message of Easter, we're being asked to stand up for the one who gave his life for us and who rose from the dead. And so, Lord, we pray for ourselves as individuals, because you ask us, Lord, in our relationship with you, there are at those times not to think about other people. And you ask us, Lord, that we would follow you. You ask us, Lord, if we love you. And so, Lord, hear the prayer of our heart. Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And help us, Lord, to follow you. And Lord, having prayed that for ourselves, then we do pray for others. And as we've worked our way through the Catching the Wave book, we pray for those, Lord, who you've laid on our hearts who do not know you yet. May they also follow you. For those, Lord, who are anxious in this situation in the world, may they follow you. But Lord, again, we're reminded not to cast too far, because we must answer for ourselves. And so, Lord, we follow you. We stand on your word, on your promises. In Jesus' name, amen. And so let's respond to God as we recognize in the song that's being sung, we stand on every promise of his word.
I will sing.
now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and evermore. Amen.